This is Business Analytics Using Forecasting. I'm Galit Shmueli. In this video, we're going to talk about autoregressive models, or simply AR models. In the previous video, we introduced autocorrelation, which is another component often present in time series. Autocorrelation captures the correlation between pairs of values of the series at a certain lag. For example, a lag 1 autocorrelation is the correlation between all immediate neighboring values in the series. The idea of autoregressive models is to capture autocorrelation in a series in a regression-type model and use it to improve short-term forecasts. The key concept here is going to be the order of the model, or the order of the AR. An autoregressive model can be used to forecast a series with no trend and no seasonality. The model looks like this. You can see it's similar to a regression model with predictors that are lagged versions of the series. In this formula, we used lags 1 to p, and therefore we call this an AR model of order p, or simply an ARP model. Although this is a regression-type model, it's estimated differently than linear regression. Specifically, we do not use least squares, but rather a method called maximum likelihood. While we won't get into the details, note that the beta estimates will be slightly different compared to simply running this as a linear regression. For this reason, we prefer to use software that has autoregressive model functions. Lastly, notice that the AR model is similar to exponential smoothing in that we're taking a weighted average of previous values, but there are a few differences. One difference is that we only take the last p values of the series. And a second difference is that the weights do not decay exponentially, but rather they're estimated from the data and can have different values. The major assumption in autoregressive models is something called stationarity. We want to assume that our series is stationary. It's not going anywhere. It means there's no trend, there's no seasonality, the level is going to be constant, and this autocorrelation that we talked about will be the same throughout the entire series. So remember that whenever we're using an AR model, this is the assumption underlying. Recall the monthly Amtrak ridership example, where the series contained both trend and seasonality. In this case, we should not directly use an AR model and use it to forecast this series, but first we have to account for those two other components. So how can we do that? In order to apply an AR model to a series that does exhibit trend and/or seasonality, we can take a two-step approach. In the first step, we capture any existing trend or seasonality patterns in the series. We've already seen several methods for removing such patterns. We can fit a linear regression, and then its residual series will no longer contain trend or seasonality. Or we can fit an advanced exponential smoothing method, and once again, the residual series should no longer contain trend or seasonality. Or we can apply differencing at appropriate lags. In the second step, we apply an AR model to the detrended and deseasonalized series in order to capture autocorrelation. We will see in this video how to do this with an AR model. In the next video, we'll see how to use the more elaborate ARMA model, autoregressive moving average model. Let's write the two-step approach using our forecasting notation so that it's clear how to generate forecasts and forecast errors. In step one, we start with the original series, denoted Y sub t, and apply any method that can capture trend and or seasonality. The result from this step is a set of forecasts, F sub t, and forecast errors, E sub t. Next, in step two, we use the series of forecast errors, E sub t. We then fit an AR model to this error series and use it to generate forecasts for the forecast errors. These forecasts are denoted E hat sub t. This means that the step two forecasts how wrong our step one forecast will be. Finally, we can also compute the errors of errors, which are the difference between our predicted forecast error and their actual values. Let's return to the Amtrak ridership example that we examined in the last videos. We fitted a linear regression model that captured trend and seasonality. And now we can use the model to compute one step ahead forecasts for April 2003. This is the first period in the validation period. The forecast is nearly 2,115,000 passengers. That's around 2.1 million passengers in that month. To see if we can improve this forecast, let's check if there's any autocorrelation left. From an ACF plot, an autocorrelation plot, we see that indeed there is autocorrelation at multiple lags. So there's a chance we can improve our forecast further. Let's move on now to step two. We now fit an AR1 model to the series of forecast errors. I'm using alphas here in place of betas to avoid confusing the parameters of our step one linear regression with the parameters of the step two AR model. Here's the resulting estimated model. We see that the constant is estimated to be 0, and alpha 1 is around 0.65. We will soon use these estimates to see if we can improve the forecasts. A small note about software. Fitting an AR model with software is typically done by choosing the ARIMA function. In R, we use the ARIMA function, apply it to the residual series, and set the order C100 to get an AR1. You can change the value of 1 to get a different order for the AR model, but keep the other two parameters at 0 for now. In XL minor, we choose the ARIMA model function, select the residual series, and set the ARP parameter to 1, and the other parameters to 0. Lastly, you might wonder why we fitted an AR1. That is because it's the simplest AR model and is often sufficient. Although we saw autocorrelations at higher lags, an AR1 might capture them. If I account for the correlation between consecutive months, it might capture correlation between months that are 2 months apart, 3 months apart, and so on. Here's the result of using our estimated AR1 model to generate forecasts for the errors in the validation period. The actual column is the actual values of the forecast errors resulting from the step one regression. The forecast column is the forecasted errors using the AR1 model. And the error column is the difference between the first two columns, or what we call the errors of errors. For example, the forecasted error for April 2003 is computed using the AR1 coefficients 0 and 0.647, and the actual error in March 2003. Let's see if the step 2 modeling captures all the autocorrelation. We can do this by plotting the AC chart of the errors of errors. We see that nothing remains. We've captured all the autocorrelation. If we'd have any autocorrelation here, we might revise step 2 with a different ARP model. The main question now is, how do we use this information to improve the step 1 forecasts? Let's recall again what we have. We started with a linear regression in step 1 to capture trend and seasonality, and we got a forecast of 2.115 million passengers in April 2003. Then we used the series of errors and modeled it with an AR1. This gave us a forecasted error of -21,860 passengers. Now we can combine the two forecasts and get our improved forecasts for April 2003. We adjust the 2115 forecast by adding the projected forecast error of -21,850. This yields an improved forecast of 2.093 million passengers. Notice the large difference between the original and improved forecasts. This gap can be significant for decision-making purposes. So what did we do? Let's put all the pieces together and see how to improve forecasts by using a two-step model with an AR model. In step one, we use some model to capture trend and or seasonality, and then generate one step ahead forecast, F(t+1). In step two, we apply an AR model to the forecast errors. This gives us a one step ahead forecast error, E(t+1). Finally, we combine the two numbers to get our improved one step ahead forecast, F(t+1). This same process can be done for a different forecast horizon, such as a two-step ahead, three-step ahead, or whatever. But typically, the AR will only work for a short horizon. An AR model is sometimes helpful and sometimes not. Specifically, an AR model is useful for improving short-term forecasts. To forecast k steps ahead, we'll use an ARP model only if k is larger than p. For example, we won't use an AR1 to forecast three steps ahead, because an AR1 only adjusts the one step ahead forecast. In other words, an ARP is only useful for improving forecasts in the next P periods. Even if you're only interested in short-term forecasting, it's not always the case that improvement provided by the second step AR model is practically worthwhile. What if the forecasts of monthly passengers are now more accurate by 10 passengers? So, make sure that the improvement is sufficiently substantial for the application at hand to justify this extra effort and complexity. To summarize, ARP models can capture autocorrelation up to lag P. The AR model assumes that there's no trend, no seasonality, and that the level and autocorrelation remain constant throughout the period. We looked at a two-step modeling approach where we first capture trend and seasonality, say with a regression model or any other model, and then we capture autocorrelation by looking at the forecast errors. Then we combine the step one forecast with a step two error and get our improved forecast. This two-step modeling approach can be useful for improving short-term forecasts, but remember that they're not typically useful for longer-term forecasts. And remember to check whether the effort is warranted or not.